God will plant you where He wants you, an idea which many of us have heard, but there could be no words more truthful when reflecting on the lives of LaVon Lefty Adams and Jolene Everett Davis Adams. Benjamin LaVon Adams, also known as Lefty, was raised by his grandparents on their farm in Quanah, Texas, where he graduated high school. He attended Parrish Junior College on a football scholarship, but graduated from West Texas State University in 1961. After going back to work for his grandparents on the family farm for a short while, it was not long before his longtime friend, Roger Waldrop, contacted him to offer him a teacher-coach position at Cal Farley's Boys Ranch. He moved there in the fall of 1961. Jolene Everett Davis was born and raised in Seminole, Texas. She was the youngest of 13 kids, and her father was a cotton farmer. As a young woman, she found herself living in Plainview and working as a telephone operator. She moved from there to First State Bank in Plainview, where she became acquainted with Shirley and Jim Pegram. In the fall of 1963, she was laid off from the bank. When in Plainview visiting Shirley and Jim, Tommy Sue mentioned that she knew of a job for Jolene. Tommy Sue was pregnant with Jamie Nan at the time and knew she would be going on maternity leave soon. This meant Mr. Wilson would need a bookkeeper to work in her place. The following Monday, Shirley traveled with Jolene to Boys Ranch to apply. Jolene was interviewed and hired on the spot. In November of 1963, Jolene moved to Boys Ranch. Specifically, they moved her into the infirmary apartments next door to bachelor Lefty Adams. As Jolene recalls, he was not there much due to his coaching responsibilities, so they did not speak much at first. One morning, they were leaving their apartments at the same time and finally found a chance to introduce themselves. Shortly after that initial encounter, he was moved to be alternate at Jim Hill dorm, where Jean and Tommy Sue Pegram were dorm parents. 2 weeks after Jolene's arrival at Boys Ranch, Lefty finally asked her out on a date, or maybe it was that she finally said yes. On February 15th, 1964, he took her on a hike to the top of Saddleback Mountain, where he popped the question. Jolene recalls that the boys had been talking about the pending engagement for several weeks, and so the following Monday, the dining hall was buzzing when the boys noticed the ring. They were married in the old B.R. Chapel on June 6, 1964, surrounded by friends, family, and many ranchers. After a short honeymoon in Santa Fe, New Mexico, Jolene recalls moving into Jim Hill dorm to join Lefty in their new role as alternate dorm parents, where she had an immediate house full of kids, literally. An immediate family. All three Adams children were born and raised at Boys Ranch. Benji came in February of 1966, Greg arrived in October of 1967, and his birth was pending Lefty's return from the Panhandle football game. Jolene found it awfully hard to wait and does not speak highly of that drive to Amarillo when he finally got home from that game. Amy surprised the whole ranch in September of 1973 as not one person expected a girl. Lefty had a nephew from Oklahoma City that needed some extra guidance, so the couple agreed Ricky Caldwell would come live with them at Boys Ranch, and as Jolene would describe it, our family was complete with the addition of Ricky. Lefty and Jolene always felt it a high privilege to have known Cal and Mimi Farley. Lefty always spoke of Mr. Farley with the highest of respect. Jolene recalls the Sunday morning in chapel when Mr. Farley came in and sat next to her on the chapel pew. He took Benji from Jolene, sat him on his lap, and played with him for a few minutes. After giving Benji back to Jolene, Mr. Farley pulled his bulletin out and started his chapel notes. Some time quickly passed, and Jolene noticed Mr. Farley resting his head on the wall behind them, and she noticed his hand and pen slowly trail off the paper. She motioned to Lefty to come over and check on Mr. Farley. Upon realizing Mr. Farley was unresponsive, Lefty carried Mr. Farley into the front office of the chapel so that rescue efforts could begin. This was one of Lefty and Jolene's most memorable events at the ranch. Jolene recalls this as an incredibly sad day for everyone that knew him. There were so many positive influences at the ranch for Lefty and Jolene, in fact, too many to name. Countless lifelong friendships were made at Boys Ranch among staff, but also amongst the boys they served. Those friendships became more like a close-knit family through the years. During their time at the ranch, Lefty served as alternate dorm parent, junior high track and basketball coach, world history and geography teacher, journalism yearbook teacher, head football and track coach, cross-country coach, and assistant athletic director. He also helped Roger Waldrop run the summer program. Head football coach meant players in and out of the family house on many nights. whether it be to pick up plays or just discuss the game plan. Benji recalls when Lefty decided he would implore the BR staff ladies to donate old pantyhose to the football team for the cold nights to keep their legs warm. Benji usually was the chosen one that was dealt the task of picking up the donations from Miss Glinda Vandergriff. Jolene remembers the moment Lefty knew he had to move out of the head football coach position. Benji and Greg were both on varsity football, and he felt it best for him to step aside in all fairness to them. He continued to be the head track coach, and later he became the head coach of the first cross-country program at BR, which went on to compete at the state meet for 13 consecutive years during his tenure as head coach. Six of those years, the state championship trophy was brought home to Boys Ranch. Five out of those 13 years, BR won second place in state, and one of those years, they won third. A bronze bust remains in the athletic building with his trophies to commemorate his tenure as cross-country coach. During the years he coached, Lefty made it a personal mission to petition the UIL board to reconsider Boys Ranch's classification in the UIL system. Due to the fact that BR was an all-boys facility, the UIL would double the enrollment number for BR in order to classify them, which resulted in putting them into a higher class than they should have been. Lefty saw this as an injustice and an illogical practice. For years, he kept statistics and enrollment numbers and prepared a case to take to the UIL in Austin. After years of persistence, he was able to convince the UIL board to lift the unnecessary false enrollment numbers, which resulted in BR moving to an appropriate and fair class in the UIL system. This in turn would lead to more fair competition for Boys Ranch. Jolene held a few different positions at the ranch, including bookkeeper at the administrative office. When the kids arrived, she transitioned to homemaker and coach support staff until the kids got older. Once Amy was in school, she began working at the elementary school as a teacher's assistant for Miss June Spivey in the reading recovery room. She recalls this as one of her favorite jobs in life, stating that it was of utmost reward to watch kids that did not believe in themselves be able to catch up to an acceptable reading level. She recalls feeling the pride right along with the child when they made progress and reached goals that they did not believe they could reach. Often in her spare time, she would also teach painting lessons to several ladies at BR. In addition to that, she would travel to Channing to the First Methodist Church every Wednesday afternoon to teach a ladies' group painting lessons. She would also volunteer for the Oldham County 4-H Club, helping teach young girls how to sew and cook, sometimes for competition. Lefty and Jolene's pride and joy was a Fellowship of Christian Athletes group that Lefty started with Mr. Latchall's help. Meetings were always at the Adams home. Jolene remembers it was so rewarding to see all the kids worshiping in song and to hear Lefty speak truth from the Bible and give his testimony. About four times a year, Lefty would take Benji, Greg, Amy, and a couple of Boys Ranchers to go pick up aluminum cans on the side of the highway so that he could raise enough money to take a group of boys to FCA camp at the YMCA of the Rockies in Estes Park, Colorado. And every year, he was able to get enough money from those cans to take 8 to 10 boys to the camp for an entire week. The camp consisted of evangelicalistic teaching from the Bible, often from famous sports figures, coaches, and athletes. Emphasis was spent on displaying Christian-like behavior on and off the field, spending quiet time in prayer and devotion, as well as improving athletic skills. The entire Adams family were also in tow for this trip and was usually the favorite family vacation. Jolene recalls that her and Lefty just wanted the boys to be reached with the soul-saving gospel of Jesus Christ, and FCA was a great opportunity to have a part in that. Lefty, Jolene, and the kids were proud members of the church at Cal Farley's until Benji and Greg became teenagers. That is when they decided to commute to Channing every Sunday to the First Baptist Church. Lefty served as a deacon of the church, and Jolene became a girls' Sunday school teacher. She became the sponsor for the Girls in Action Club at the church. She would take a group of about 6 to 8 girls to summer camp at Pan Fork Christian Camp outside of Wellington every summer. Jolene retired from BR school system in 1993. Her career at Boys Ranch was a span of 30 wonderful years, as she would describe it. In the fall of 1993, she went on to work full-time as a teacher's assistant in the special ed department at Lakeview Elementary in the Canyon School District. After working there for 10 years, she entered full retirement from the school system. She then decided to work part-time at the Youth Detention Center of the High Plains and worked there for several years. Lefty fully retired from the ranch in 1995. His tenure lasted 34 years, and those that knew him would say he enjoyed every moment. He began work at the ranch because a friend showed up in Quanah to offer him a job, and, well, He needed a job. By the time he left Boychurch, it had become his ministry. In his retirement, he went on to substitute in the high-risk room at Lakeview Elementary until his health started to decline after his first stroke in 1996. They spent their latter retirement years serving as members of the First Baptist Church of Canyon, where they enjoyed more time with their Sunday school friends. Jolene enjoyed volunteering in the prison ministry through the church for several years. They loved spending time with grandkids. Both Lefty and Jolene believed a perk of being a grandparent was watching grandkids' sports, and they lovingly took the job of biggest fan to each grandkid. They enjoyed going to the old-timer breakfast that Lamont and Francis Waldrop would organize. Yearly attendance at the rodeo and reunion was a must, as BR was still home and BR friends and ex-ranchers were still their family. They continued to support the Cal Farley's Boys Ranch Alumni Association. Benji and his wife, Mary Alice, made their home in Childress, Texas. They have three grown sons, Tyler, Trey, and Thomas, one daughter-in-law, Iliatha, and four very active grandchildren. Benji's favorite memory of life at BR was watching film with Dad when he and Greg were in elementary school. He recalls that Lefty would teach them about reading the defense and offense of the opponent, also going to FCA camp every summer. Greg made the DFW area his home. He has three grown children, Kirsten, Andrew, and Bailey. He also has two beautiful grandchildren. Greg's favorite memories include Lefty letting him and Benji help put playbooks together for the football team and picking up the cans on the side of the highway for FCA camp. Also sitting on the back porch with Mom drinking coffee. Amy and husband Derek Brasher reside in Amarillo. They have two grown children, Aubrey and Sam. Amy recalls some of her favorite memories included FCA meetings at the house, picking up cans on the side of the highway with Dad, and FCA camp in the summer. She also enjoyed long walks with Mom to the riverbed to look for cattails, and long talks with Jolene and Pat Waldrop on the back porch. Lefty passed away in 2005, but we continue to see his legacy in the many lives he touched while he was with us. He was laid to rest with his stopwatch in his hand and his famous bucket hat on his chest, just within a couple of miles of the famous riverbed he loved. His expectation of excellence has driven many of us to be where we are today. Jolene continues to live in Amarillo. Her love and kindness and fun-loving personality have also touched many lives on and off the ranch. She enjoys time with her family and friends. The Adams' personal mission statement can be seen in their example. 100 years from now, it will not matter what my bank account was, the sort of house I lived in, or the kind of car I drove, but that the world might be different because I was important in the life of a child.